Hi there. In this tutorial, I'm going to demonstrate how to create an effect something like this. So this isn't really about the actual shapes in this video. This is about the effect of what I'm calling video echo or video feedback. So I just created a couple of different animations and then fed these back through a node setup in order to give this effect. I did several different versions. In this one and the one before it, it was basically a time delay, so you can see there's just a slight time delay between them. And then I increased it quite a bit more for this one, and you can see how the front shape is moving at a slightly different time to the other. And then I used one of my older videos and did the same thing to that. So the good thing about this method is that you can take any video, whether it's a sequence of images or a video file itself, and plug that into Blender using this node setup and create some interesting effects. The final thing I did was also add some rotation to it, and of course it's scaling as well, and that just again created quite an interesting, almost like a feather effect on this one. The basic idea is very simple, but it can very quickly add up to quite a complicated appearing node setup, although you don't have to do it that way. I'm not going to render a scene per se, but I will go into EV mode, and as you'll see, the rendering of the frames is relatively quick. So I'm going to go and open a new window up, and we'll make that window the compositor. Although there's nothing in the scene, I'm just going to do a render, and that will just show us very quickly the composited output. And that's fine, just so that we can see what we're doing. There are other ways to do that. So we'll say use nodes, and you can see we've got render layers here at the moment. We don't need those. I'm going to add an input, which is an image sequence. And we'll select all the frames and import the sequence and drop that there. And by default, it knows how many frames there were. It will start at frame one and have an offset of zero. If we plug that into our composite output, you can see what the scene is. So it's just a few shapes with some interesting lighting, and they move around from frame to frame. So the next I'm going to add a distort node, which is a scale. And if I just drop that in there, initially, as you can see, it doesn't do anything. I'm going to set that to 1.15, and you can see the image expanded a little there, and the other one to 1.15 as well. So that's just scaled up the image slightly. And now I need to add, under color, a color mix node. Drop that there. I'm going to put the scaled image into the bottom, the new image into the top, and set that to add. Now you can immediately see where we're going. We've got our original image and our new image. And if I set that to about 0.4, the new image is slightly darker than the original image. In an ideal world, what we would do is then feed that back around in some fashion, and this would take that output, duplicate it again, and then carry out the same functions. And this would give us our effectively infinite feedback. Unfortunately, because nodes are really just an interface for creating almost a program, a sequence of codes that Blender follows, it isn't allowed. It doesn't permit you to do that because it would probably create infinite recursion. Essentially, Blender would never finish doing the job it set out to do. So what we need to do for each time that we want to add another echo, as it were, we need to add some more nodes. So if I take these two points, and I should say at the moment, this is using the same image. So although there are duplicates of the image and they are each scaled, there's no difference in terms of the time domain. So they are the same image. It's just a bit bigger. So let's just duplicate this for a moment and drop that in there. And again, put the image there and there. And we also need to just take it into there as well. So now we've got several multiples, and let's just do that once more. And you can see that's quickly giving us some interesting effects. However, at the moment, there is no difference in the time domain. So they're all the identical image each time I go to a new image. Something else you will notice is that there is actually a render time now. To see, it's taking a second or so to do. So while it's tempting to do, say, 100 repeats of this up here, you could group it into a block and then repeat that block. You'll quickly find that it started to take us more significant amount of time. It's still a lot faster than rendering a high resolution scene, but it still starts to add up, especially when you're rendering an animation. But there's a way to deal with that too. So how do we get the effect of the time domain? So in other words, where you have the initial image and then the follow-on images are slightly behind. So now we need to add more versions of our scene. So I'm going to take my original image sequence Let's just cut some of these additional ones out for the moment and tie that back in there. So we've just got one echo now. And now I'm going to take the image from this second node for the image sequence. So it's still the same file. And at the moment, they're all tied together. You can see it's same number of frames and so on. But what we'll do is we'll add an offset. You need to experiment with what sort of offset works for you. The offset is the offset in frames. So I found something in the order of 3 worked quite well when you had a reasonably fast moving scene. But let's try double that for the moment. Let's put 6 in. And you can immediately see there's quite a big difference between one frame and the next, or the echo. So if I put that back down to 3, I think, you can see that they are different. If I go to the beginning, essentially, one is 3 frames ahead of the other. And obviously, when you then start to replicate that whole thing, you need to replicate the image node as well. So we'll duplicate that. We'll put that there. So the image from this set goes into here. But this time, we need to use a new image sequence. So we're not multiplying the whole set here. All we're doing is adding another delayed sequence. But this one needs to be a different offset. So we'll put 6 frames offset on this one. And obviously that needs to connect to the output. So at the moment, I've just got my original image, and then every successive image is just scaled by 1.15 larger. It doesn't need to be, of course. It could just be going straight through. They're exactly the same size now. But I think given you're also going to want to reduce the brightness of it, it sort of adds something to it. And they will occasionally hide each other if you don't scale them, but that's up to you. It's whatever you want to do. So the next thing we need to do is to be able to make the scale of this version of the image bigger than the scale of this version. So we're going to need to add some add nodes. And before we do that, we'll also provide the input into these sections. I'm going to add an input, which is a value, and we'll set that to 0.15. So this is essentially how much we scale each image. I'm then going to add a converter, which is a math node, which defaults to the add node. On the one side, I'm going to use the value I put in here, and I've done it this way rather than just entering it directly for a reason. And on the other side, I'm just going to put 1. I could have just put 0.15 in here, but this is going to make it easier in a moment. I'm trying to keep the nodes laid out so that it's reasonably easy to see what's going on. So this is now adding the value in here to 1, and we can then plug that into here. So we'll take that add node and bring it over here. We'll take that value and put it into one side. It doesn't really matter which side. And then we'll take a version of the value out of here, which of course is 1.15 at the moment, and put that into the other side. So we're taking 1.15, and then again we're adding another 0.15 to it. And then that forms the scale value that we put into this side. So you can now start to see how this sort of adds up. So if I take these nodes again, duplicate them, I'll take my building up image, put that into there, and the output into there. Again, I take my 0.15, put that into this side, and I take the added up value from here and put it into there. And you can now see how it starts to get bigger and bigger and bigger. And the good thing is, if I want to change the rate at which it scales up, I can just change this number here, say change it to 0.1, and the difference in scale is much smaller. But of course, what I also need to do, I've got an offset of 3 here, 6 here, I need to set this one to, say, 9. It's unfortunate that there isn't a little node input here. I'm sure you could set up a driver to do this, such that it would be a value of over here plus a number. But you, as I said before, you're not really going to do too many of these, because you'll quickly find that by the time you get up to 7 or 8 repetitions, it will start to slow down. But that's not a problem. So what we've got now is something that will scale each version of the image, in this case larger, it could be smaller. It will make it slightly dimmer by currently 0.4, and it will also be slightly delayed in the time frame. So let's put another value input. We'll set this to 0.4 at the moment, and we can then connect that in here in order for us to be able to change all of these fade factors, if you want to call them that, together. So if I put this to a smaller number, the echoes will fade out more quickly. If I put it to a larger value, they will fade out much more slowly. We'll go for 0.25, I think. Next, if we wanted to add some rotation to it, So we need to add a distort node, which is a rotate node. So that's our first image, which is going to be the default position. Here's our second image. So we'll drop our rotate node in there. And if we add some offsets into here, let's say 10, you can see the whole image has started to rotate. And again, we can do pretty much the same thing as we did with the scale. We put 5 degrees in there, plug that into there. That's now created a rotated version of the image, and all of these successive ones will be using that. But obviously we want them to rotate as well. So we need to put another rotate node in. You can put it before or after the scale. It doesn't matter too much. But this time, if we just take our value, our rotate value, and plug that into there, this will just rotate it the same amount. What you could do is link the rotation amount to the scale amount. So effectively, rather than a simple add node, we create a multiply node, take the output of our add node into there and our value into there, and then that becomes the degrees that we plug into there. And then we can use a much smaller rotation amount, obviously. And there are various other ways that you can combine this. Now, very quickly, you can see this becomes quite a spider's nest. But the little trick, if you want to be able to add lots and lots of video echoes to a given sequence, and that sequence, as I said, can be in a movie file or just an image sequence, is that once you've created a render of, let's say, something with 3 or 4 echoes on it, you can take the output that you've created, the video file or the image sequence, and then operate this same node setter on that output. And that will then magnify again the original video echoes. It will sort of do echoes in between each one. So you could just do some fairly large offsets, either in the time domain with time offsets or in the scale, and then do an intermediate scale and operate that on the same image again. So as I say, it does make a bit of a mess, and you will want to group things, but you will also find if you go too many steps in one go, they will take quite a while to process. It's creating quite a lot of code behind here to generate this video feedback. And wherever possible, I do recommend adding sort of these values here. It complicates it. It makes it look like a spider's nest very quickly, but it does make it a lot easier to control. And of course, as I said, you can group all of this should you wish to, like that. And then it can just be one node. And if you need to, you can bring other outputs into it. And there it all is in there. So that was just a quick tutorial. I hope you found that useful, and I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot. So I hope you found that interesting. If you did, let me know. If you enjoy these tutorials, don't forget to click like and subscribe. I also have a Facebook page and a Twitter account, and I now have a Patreon page as well. And I'll provide links to all of those in the description below. So I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.